You are recording. Okay, good.
Six people who didn't take the quiz on Friday, and this is the last makeup. I brought them, but I'm not going to be bringing them Wednesday, etc. So those people have to take the makeup today if they're going to have the makeup. Which is what you see, your blood type A, B, O, or AB. There are genotypes. These are the homozygous ones for A, B, and O. And because O is recessive, only people who are homozygous for O have that blood type, have that phenotype. And then you also have heterozygous, having two different alleles. A, O is a heterozygote, B, O, and AB. So we discuss the details of that. And people use to predict what the outcomes will be of crossing two homozygotes or crossing two heterozygotes, and the outcomes being babies, they use something called a Punnett square. So here we know that if an individual is heterozygote, we're going to cross two heterozygotes. We know that they will be forming sperm, and I have sperm going down. That is either if this is for tall, they either have the capital T for tall or the little T for short. And they have, if they're females making eggs, they will have the capital T or the little T. And a person who is heterozygote, exactly half of their sperm will be carrying the tall allele and the other half the short, and the same for a female with her eggs. And that way, if we know that the allele frequency of your sperm is 1/2 of T, so the allele frequency would be 0.5 in decimals or 1/2, and for little t, the short would be 1/2. For the eggs, it would be 1/2 T, capital T tall, and 1/2 short. We can actually then predict the outcomes, and it would be a chance. So you think of all these eggs and sperms as being in a shake and bake bag, just randomly hitting each other, which is what happens during fertilization. You don't know what particular sperm will hit which particular egg. And so you get the probability of making a homozygote for tall is the frequency of the tall allele in this sperm times the frequency of the tall allele in the egg. With the two heterozygotes, then you get 1/2 times 1/2 equals 1/4. So the numbers of babies that you should be making when you cross two heterozygotes is 1/4 for homozygous dominant. If you then have a tall egg hitting a short sperm, the frequency is also 1/2 times 1/2, or 1/4, that a tall egg will hit a short sperm to make another heterozygote in the future generation. But then you can also have short eggs that are going to hit tall sperm, and the frequency of that kind of heterozygote made that way is 1/2 × 1/2, which is 1/4. Therefore, when Mendel crossed two heterozygotes, he found that actually 2 × 1/4, which is 1/2, of his individuals were heterozygotes. And 1/4 were homozygous for tall. When he self-crossed them to each other, they could only produce tall from generation to generation. But another set of tall plants that he self-crossed could produce both tall and short. And that is because they themselves were heterozygotes. So he got the 2 × 1/4, which is 1/2 of them, were heterozygous plants that could produce both short and tall plants in future generations. And then he got 1/4 of his plants that were homozygous for short. And the probability of getting that is 1/2 × 1/2, which is 1/4. So if you think about something interesting on this Punnett square, which is you have two parents, one is female and one is male. Now the male will have, if these are the sperm going down, imagine in your mind, this is an X and this is a Y. What two sex chromosomes do females have? They have two X's. So females will only have eggs that have X's. So imagine, keep in mind, those are two X's and this is one X. Well, here you've got XX. XX. If this is a Y, it would be XY, XY. And that's why for every sexually reproducing organism, you get 1/2 males and 1/2 females born generation after generation after generation. And you can figure that out on a Punnett square. Now, how do we go from Mendel's experiments, which were ignored during his time, to the rediscovery of them? How that happened is through the improvements in the microscope that allowed people to look at cells and actually see nuclei and actually see these little colored bodies that form in the nuclei or become visible in the nuclei shortly before cell division. So here, scientists were looking at nuclei. They could see other kinds of organelles in the cell. Mitochondria is called the powerhouse of the cell. It's where a lot of your metabolic processes take place. The breaking down of sugars and whatnot. And so this actually has its own kind of chromosomes along here. So people could see that there were mitochondria, and we now know that these were once separate organisms that divided simply through a process we call mitosis, and their chromosomes and their DNA along the chromosomes actually duplicates and then it splits, etc. So they could see mitochondria, they could see cell membranes, they could see nuclear membranes, and all of this other stuff. And as they were looking at the cells, they could study the cells in cell division. And what they saw as they improved and improved those microscopes was some amazing stuff. So here are a picture of the colored bodies that are our chromosomes. Humans have 23 different kinds. We mentioned the X and the Y. And they tended to line them up from tallest to shortest. So in lab this week, you're going to be sorting your chromosomal pairs. They then noticed that sperm and egg, when they were looking,
Isn't it 46?
Total, yes, there's 23 different types of chromosomes, and there's pairs, one that you got from mom and one that you got from dad. But I should have said 23 different types of chromosomes that occur in pairs in the body. So total of 46. So when you look at sperm and egg, those particular sex cells, you only see one of each pair, so there you see just 23 in each one, but there'll be one of each of these different types. So they could see that under the microscope. We know that they have pinch points to them, centromeres. They have the long part or quantum part that they call U, and the little petite small part that they call P. And so they also know that when they put different dyes into the dish that has the chromosomes in them, that they pick up those dyes based on the chemistry of the chromosome. So when we get to the nucleotides in a minute, these will be a lot of G's and C's, and they dye particularly darker. So they can see these different bands, and that also helped them to identify these different chromosomes. Here, we know now that the chromosome is, and we've only known this since about the 1950s to 60s, is a coiled up kind of a ribbon. So it actually coils up on itself, and it's what we call a double helix. It has two sides, and we sometimes think of it like a flexible ladder, a ribbon-like ladder, and this side of the ladder has what we call phosphate and sugar base, phosphate and sugar backbone to the two sides of the chromosome, and then between here are the base pairs, and these represent individual nucleotides. There are only four nucleotides that make up the rungs of this ladder. Adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine. Now, I always try to remember which ones go together because only two actually fit together, and it's the chemical properties that are attracted to each other. But look at the T and C and the adenine and the G. Now think this, C kind of looks like G. Those two actually, man, they're attractive, cytosine and guanine.